brought to you by the Connecticut Lottery. This is Steve Kochko on the Connecticut Public Information Network.
Hi, this is Bob Crane. You're listening to the Al Warren Show, and it's true that Al's lazy, dishonest, bad-tempered, drinks, is always late and shiftless. Come on, folks, no man's perfect.
Oh, stop the music, stop the music. That was good. Bob Crane, the living legend.
Al, I was listening to you on my way to the studio today, and I said it's been almost 20 years since I did the early morning show here on WICC, and it's ironic that the station is now celebrating its 50th anniversary while I'm in town. I mean, this year. I'm actually doing a telethon this weekend up in Hartford for my good friend Eliot Dober, cerebral palsy telethon. But to come to town and listen to WICC and hear Al Warren doing the radio show, I never heard of you.
Boy, Bob, thanks a lot.
No, but the amazing thing, Al, is my son Jimmy, he's not quite that young, but my cousin Jimmy Senich worked at this station after I did, yeah. And you sound like my cousin Jim.
Well, Jim and I are dearest friends.
And I'm listening on the way up today, and I'm saying, that's Jimmy's voice. It's Jimmy's approach to music. It's the, you know, it's, but it, it, no, all kidding aside, it's great being here.
Oh, Bob, it's a pleasure to have you. You know, we talk about WICC and its anniversary, 50th anniversary, and invariably, when anybody mentions WICC, they mention Bob Crane still. And I say this in all sincerity, you are what you call a living legend. I never talked to a living legend before.
Well, I thank you for the compliment. Let me just say, without WICC and being on this station in my early days in show business, nothing else would have happened for me along the line, you know, because it's always the story, who is the one that gave you your start or what helped you along the way. It was the fact that WICC has such a tremendous listening audience and a powerful signal that I don't know whether the antenna ground wires are still laying in Long Island Sound, but people used to say to me, are they? Well, people used to say to me, why is the station so popular? I said, it's a good spot on the dial, 600. And I said, and they've got their ground wires out in the water, and the water goes up and down the coast. So being in this town, you never know who's listening. And people can, they're now bringing me another microphone. That's, it's for FM.
No, PM.
That's for PM, yes. There's an old-fashioned microphone here. That precedes me in the business. They've got one of these old things that's just hanging on springs and whatnot. But when I was in this town, they had such things as Miller Ross, was the paper store on the corner of Main Street. Was it Miller Ross?
That's right, he's still there.
He's still there, Bob.
Miller Ross is not on the corner of Main Street.
No, it's on the corner of John and Main right now.
Is it still on the corner?
Yeah, the news corner.
Well, where the park is, right next to City Hall.
That's where he used to be.
That's where he used to be. I knew he had changed. Because I stopped there to pick up my paper at noon today.
Tough to buy from an empty corner.
And I was talking to a lady waiting for the bus, and she thought I was being, you know, and the fact I had a raincoat on, it was just disgusting, the whole thing was. And they said, Bob Crane's come back to town, stop those old tricks.
Listen, Bob.
What?
What is this I hear? That is it true that the rumor that I heard that you may go back into Hogan's Heroes?
I may go back to ICC. I mean, I don't know.
Well, no. Listen, I'm going on vacation. You want to do a week?
No, I would love to, Al, if I were going to stay around. No, I'll tell you, the National Enquirer had an article, a column item a couple of weeks ago that Hogan's Heroes was going to be reactivated, but that was a misunderstanding. I'm working with the producer of Hogan's Heroes right now, Ed Feldman. We're getting together a military show that involves the Second World War but is not Hogan's Heroes. But the newspaper thought we were reviving because it's the same initial people. It's the producer and the star of Hogan's Heroes getting together again, but we're not going to do Hogan's again.
What about movies, Bob? You got anything lined up for movies?
Well, I saw one last night.
How was it?
You know, it was good. You know, no, I did Super Dad a couple of years ago for Disney, and that made $7 million. There's a possibility I may do another Disney movie. I just signed a $1 million contract with CBS. Now, if I can get them to sign... you know, all those old jokes that I used to use when I was here.
Using them now, Bob. And they're great. They still work.
Jokes. They still work. Sure they do. There's no light in the men's room. Do you still use that? Or what was the other one that I used to use when I was on the air? There was another...
My favorite one was the... You'd ad-lib a commercial, and a voice off mic would say, where'd you fire that out?
Oh, yeah.
On the back of a macaroni truck.
Read it on the back of a macaroni truck.
The funny one.
What?
when you used to audition the new records?
On Sunday afternoon, we used to have the chicken that rated the new releases. And for 2 hours, from 3 to 5 on Sunday afternoon, that went on for almost 3 years, I think. We had a chicken, and to make the gag work, the chicken used to lay the eggs, and for any of the old-time listeners to ICC would remember, the chicken would go, and then you'd hear the egg hit the pot and go plonk, and then this voice would say, another! And he would lay. One egg was excellent, two was good, three was fair, and four was poor. Well, that was supposed to be all that a record could get. Four eggs was the worst. Poor, right? We'd play Johnny Ray's record of The Little White Cloud That Cried, and I'll never forget it. And I said, okay, chicken, there's the new release, Johnny Ray singing Little White Cloud That Cried. What's the rating? And the chicken went, I said, one egg, excellent. And then you'd hear, I said, oh, I'm sorry, that's two eggs. That's me. And it went three, and I said, oh, my goodness. And then you, and you hear, the, and oh, four eggs. And now I'm going to a commercial, and you still hear the chicken in the background. I'm saying, my goodness gracious, I got eggs up to my waist here. And we went to two commercials, and the chicken was still laying eggs. And people were still talking about the Johnny Ray record. Got 52 eggs. It was the worst record ever. Of course, it became one of the biggest selling records for Johnny. That's how much my chicken knew. But I believed in the chicken. And people would say to me, I would have artists. Andy Williams came to town once, and he said, would you let me know what the chicken rates the record? Andy Williams believed that my chicken really rated those, you know, and my chicken was a record, you know, but Andy thought I really had a chicken that laid eggs. Oh, weird, weird.
Well, Bob, you left here and you went to KNX, right?
Yes, in Hollywood.
And then from there, Heroes, yeah. Donna Reed Show.
Donna Reed, and then Hogan's Heroes and whatnot. And Al, I know a lot of your listeners are probably waiting for your music because we've been talking for 6 or 7 minutes here. And this is the station that guarantees continuous music.
Oh, dynamite music.
I mean, even your commercials have music going.
Even the commercials are dynamite.
Yeah, so
the Weiner Motors commercial.
The Weiner, are they still using my drumming on the Weiner's commercial?
Tell us about the drumming, Bob, at the band at the Ritz.
I used to play with Joey Zell's band occasionally when his regular drummer was not available. And I played at so many bar mitzvahs and weddings. In
parking
this,
lot openings?
Parking. I played at the mall. I had two jobs. I was a musician at night. I worked for Ray Collinari maybe once out at the Ritz Ballroom. And Ray remembers when the bands used to come through this area. And before the Ritz became a furniture store. Great nostalgia, Ray. Stop crying in the corner. And, to recognize that Glenn Miller was out at the Ritz and Vaughn Monroe in his early days. And, great nostalgia for us. For my son, who's 24 years old, he says, Dad, who's Charlie Barnett? Or my daughter said to me the other day, who's Tommy Dorsey? And I have to recognize these kids today could care less about what we consider great nostalgia. Now, the kids that are growing up today, 25 years from now, they'll suddenly be saying, whatever happened to John Denver? Great nostalgia. John, whatever happened to John? Or whatever happened? It's almost like the Beatles now. Somebody makes an offer just last week, Bill Sargent or somebody made an offer of something like $7 or $8 million for the Beatles to come back.
Yeah.
The Beatles are now nostalgia.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's ridiculous, but the 50s are a great nostalgia.
They're holding out for more, Bob.
They're holding out for more than
what? Holding out for more money.
I don't know where we're going.
I'll do it. If they ask me, I'll go.
Hey, I'd do it for, let me tell you. Al, I want to tell you that it's been my pleasure being back here on WICC and especially being on your show. And I'm going to show up on Bob's show in the morning, too, one of these days. We did a couple of short things. And I'm just sorry that while I'm in the area here, I can't get to meet some of the people that I knew so well when I was here because I worked for ICC for 6 years. And during that time, you get to meet a lot of friends. Pat Giuliano was the head engineer then. And Harry Downey was here.
Frank Delfino.
Frank Delfino. Dick Alexander.
Al Brown.
Yeah. I mean, those were the names of the people that we had. That's all nostalgia for me now.
You know, people talk about when they were driving to work in the morning, and you'd say things like, everyone who's going to GE now, let's hear it with the horns. You know? They still talk about those crazy things.
Well, you know, in those days, anybody that did something out of the normal, and what was normal then was a disc jockey would come on like Martin Block, this is the make-believe ballroom, and here's Vaughn Monroe. And that was basically all you did. So you get a guy that came in and just talked like a regular Joe, you know, like the guy at the gas station. They said, what is that? Who needs this bum? And that's basically my stock and trade was then sounding like the guy next door. if you live next door to a drunk. And I never sounded like the guy next door. Huh? You live next door to a girl. I'm sorry. Somebody's nodding his head in there. But anyway, Al, let me tell you, it's been my pleasure being on with you. And good luck in your career.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think you're too big for the area. People used to say that to me. How often did you hear that, Ray? You're too big for the area.
Well, you know what it is when they compare you to Bob Crane.
Is that what it is?
I'll tell you. You said a yardstick that's kind of hard to measure up to, you know.
Let me tell you, it's my pleasure being back.
Well, Bob, thank you for coming down. You certainly have made my day, and I'm sure our audience. Folks, you've just heard a living legend, Mr. Bob Crane. Bob, thank you very much.
And let me just say, this is Bob Crane, and the latest audience ratings are in. The most popular part of the Al Warren Show, selected by the listeners, was the school cancellations.
Okay, Bob, thank you very much. Thanks again, Bob.
Thank you, Al.